You're about to embark on the greatest adventure in human history, a mission to Mars, and you're doing it in style aboard Starship, the largest manned rocket ever built. You're experiencing the pinnacle of space travel, a fusion of NASA expertise and cutting-edge private sector innovation. This isn't just any spaceflight. Lights, buttons, dials? Should you press one? Wait, what are those strange tubes for? Discovery of the dirty secret of life aboard Starship, and much more in this episode of The Infographic Show. What life inside the SpaceX Starship will be like. There are some truly elite groups out there, US presidents, Super Bowl-winning quarterbacks, world record holders at the Olympics, and of course astronauts who have been on manned space missions. But that last crowd might be about to get a whole lot bigger. In the past, missions have been observation flights, jaunts to the International Space Station, or for a lucky few, journeys to the moon. Those usually had a crew of only a few astronauts, always under 10. But if one project gets off the ground, that is going to change. 10 people in a rocket? How about 100? How is that possible? It's all the result of a lot of research and funding from NASA and development of funding from the world's most famous, or infamous, billionaire, Elon Musk. The South African-born tech magnate has made it clear he wants to take the US back to space and be the one to put humans on Mars. While NASA has de-emphasized this goal over the years, he's made it his top priority. Like everything else he does, the advancement of this goal through SpaceX has been public, aggressive, and filled with flashy stunts and spectacular fails. But he is undeterred. If a few rockets blow up after launch, that's lessons learned for the next one, on to bigger projects. And they don't get any bigger than Starship. The largest manned rocket ever developed, Starship is designed to be a crewed reusable rocket with a payload of up to 330,000 pounds and a crew capacity of up to 100 people. Designed for deep space exploration, it's a far sturdier and more advanced rocket than the ones that got the US to the moon. And it's designed for much longer journeys. After all, it only took days to get to the moon. For those brave explorers who seek to break Earth's orbit and make their way to the red planet, they're likely to be spending up to 6 months in transit. Which raises the question, is that even survivable? Humans have actually spent equivalent time in space, aboard the International Space Station. This massive collaboration between the US, Russia, Europe, Japan, and Canada is located in low Earth orbit and hosts scientists and astronauts for longer-term research and exploration. This is a great place to study the space environment and examine the effects of microgravity on plants and humans. In fact, we are currently seeing exactly how long humans can stay out there safely. A pair of scientists who were scheduled to return to Earth in June 2024 had their stay extended by almost a year due to malfunctions in their Boeing-designed return ship. But the ISS is designed for living. Could Starship duplicate that on a travel vessel? In a word, no. Life on Starship will certainly be interesting, but for those astronauts signing up for an extended voyage, they can expect it to be a challenge of the body and of the mind. But it's going to be far closer to possible than ever before to make a long-term voyage. Part of the reason Starship is so massive is because it's going to be transporting a hefty payload, including life support systems, essential survival supplies, and likely the building blocks of the first human outpost on Mars. This means very careful planning, but it also provides a little room for error, because on a journey like this, a lot could go wrong. One of the biggest challenges for the Starship crew will be the toll such a journey takes on the human body. And one of the greatest hazards of long-distance space travel until now has been the lack of gravity. The human body isn't meant to withstand minimum gravity environments for long. Those who return to Earth after long-term missions have reported a decrease in bone mass, among other medical complications. One proposed solution is to slowly spin the ship while traveling, in hopes of generating enough artificial gravity for passengers to be able to walk rather than float. That could provide some relief, but don't expect much in the way of space. Early Starship designs painted a picture of spacious interiors complete with private quarters for rest and recreation, but in reality, even on the ISS, every inch of space is optimized. On a mission this long, life support systems, emergency backups, and backups for those backups will take up a significant portion of the ship. That spacious vision might shrink fast. While early manned missions to space to test the viability of the ship might have more room and smaller crews, that will change when the ship starts preparing for long-term missions with larger crews. If the ship actually aims to fit 100 people on board, it's likely that private quarters will resemble those in submarines more than anything else. Enough space to lie down, but not much else. But that might be enough, because the crew will be busy. For early missions, it's likely everyone on board will be heavily trained in the ins and outs of the Starship, and they'll be tasked with monitoring its functions. While the Starship is the most advanced ship ever designed, it's been far from flawless, with several early unmanned rockets failing to launch successfully and costing untold millions of dollars. But that is far better than the alternative if they were manned. The loss of the Challenger and Columbia space shuttles devastated the NASA space program, with the deaths of the astronauts casting a pall over the future of manned missions and leading SpaceX to step in. If anything goes wrong, the manned Starship could meet the same fate and take the crew with it. But for future missions, the rest of the crew might be fighting an even bigger enemy than the emptiness of space – boredom. Long-term missions like the journey to Mars will likely involve dozens of crew members who don't play a role in the operations of the spaceship. Engineers will be vital for constructing a Martian outpost, botanists will oversee terraforming experiments, medical specialists will care for the crew, and then there are the specialized experts who will only be needed if something goes wrong. So day to day, they won't really be required on the extended journey. Nothing for them to do but just kick back and relax. It sounds great, right? Think again. Remember when you were in school, you finished your work early and then you just had to sit there? Outside entertainment wasn't allowed, and pulling out your phone certainly wasn't. Suddenly, it seemed like that hand on the clock was moving at 1/10 the speed. Waiting around with nothing to do can feel like torture, and even minutes of it can feel like hours. Now, try months. The biggest challenge facing astronauts on a Starship may not be for their bodies, but for their minds. This will no doubt be explored as plans for the mission ramp up, with entertainment being preloaded onto the ship to allow them to watch movies and TV series while in transit. But there's one thing they won't be doing: watching the latest episodes of the infographic show. Internet access in deep space is a tricky challenge. After all, signals need to come from somewhere. Most astronaut communications will happen through closed circuits, and while the International Space Station has Wi-Fi, it's limited to operational use. That means no mindless scrolling through cat memes on Elon Musk's X unless he preloads them into the system somehow. It also means communications with loved ones back home might be challenging. But hey, at least they'll have dozens of new friends on board, right? Most of the previous space shuttle jaunts have not only been shorter, they've involved tighter crews. The crew mostly trained together and they knew each other well, and the few civilian or foreign members were integrated quickly onto the team. That's likely not going to be possible with such a large crew, so it's almost inevitable that some personality conflicts will emerge. Add in conflicts over who outranks who, and it's enough to make anyone want to get away from the crowds and get some fresh air, except that's not really going to happen in deep space. At least there is something to look forward to. Chow time! It used to be that astronaut food was kind of a joke. There were all sorts of comedy bits about mysterious pastes and tubes that had the names of food that people ate on Earth. But times have changed and astronauts are actually fed pretty well now, although the chow may still take some getting used to. Anything served in space has to be very carefully self-contained in a zero-gravity environment. The good news is, astronauts who want something fresher might be in luck. The International Space Station has been engaged in pioneering experiments in growing crops in space. The ones that they've had the most success with are the hardier vegetables like lettuce, cabbage, and kale. So you'll be eating your veggies in space, but those looking for something sweet may have to content themselves with that space ice cream that you used to have at the planetarium. Fruits are more delicate, and there have been few experiments in growing them so far. It's likely that Starship might come with a built-in garden designed to absorb the solar rays and grow some healthy veggies for the crew mid-mission. After all, the ship will be in space for over half a year, and it'll be carrying precious cargo. While the first Starship to make the voyage will be carrying a large crew, it's likely to be carrying something just as important – the supplies for the first human outpost on Mars. While any sort of colonization or terraforming of Mars is a pipe dream for the time being, scientists are very interested in establishing the first research outpost there. So far, we've had to make do with limited data sets from robot explorers, but a human research team would be able to gather 10 times the data in half the time. A short-term research mission to Mars will need just more than a landing site, it'll need a base. That means Starship will be packed with construction supplies, an extended food reserve, and perhaps most importantly, the seeds for the first Martian garden, grown in a controlled enclosed environment. This would mean that despite Starship's massive size, the space on board might be a little cramped. Now let's get to something a little messier. Food on board the ships is getting better. That is great. But what goes in must come out. How astronauts use the bathroom has been something that has fascinated people, especially little boys, for decades. Astronauts actually wear diapers for launches because you can't take a break while shooting off into space. But the ships are thankfully equipped with advanced technology for bathroom breaks today. But that doesn't mean it's always comfortable. Astronauts typically use a vacuum hose for number one and a vacuum toilet for number two. Starship will be equipped with a new multi-purpose toilet that lets astronauts take care of their business in one go if needed, rather than having to use two different devices. And the ship will have a few other advantages that past ships didn't. One of the biggest problems of long-distance space travel until now has been keeping the human body in shape. We all know how our body gets out of whack when we don't exercise for a long time. Like when that new video game comes out and all we want to do is play it for the next 5 days. Then everything seems to be a little harder to do once you step back into the light of day. Well, that problem is magnified when astronauts are in space for months at a time. So the odds are the astronauts would be briefed on a very structured exercise program before heading off into space. Got to keep limber after all. And this is much easier with convenient artificial gravity. So you're probably going to have regular workout periods for the astronauts, staggered to maximize space. But it's not just about keeping the body sharp, it's about keeping the mind sharp. The flight time is long, and more than enough for anyone to go stir-crazy. Odds are that tensions will eventually arise between the large group of people who share the spaceship. So the plans for the mission will definitely incorporate some ways to keep everyone occupied and prevent irritability and mental issues. This will include a hefty collection of reading material, likely digitized, to allow astronauts to pick and choose whatever interests them. The spaceship will also likely be equipped with a closed-circuit technology that allows recorded messages from home. It would allow for enrichment classes, both relating to the mission and to other interesting topics. And it might just provide the most important connection of all. One of the biggest challenges astronauts face is the intense loneliness that comes from being separated from your loved ones for months at a time. And this will be the longest intentional mission ever. There's no doubt that almost everyone on board will be deeply homesick, especially if they've left spouses and kids behind. As long as the ship is able to maintain its closed-circuit connection with NASA, the people on the ground will be able to provide videos from home and even arrange video calls with their man or woman in the sky. This might just provide the mental health boost everyone needs to make it through the mission, and hopefully keep everyone ready to go when they hit the red planet. There are several critical failure points for the mission. The first, the launch, can be controlled pretty well. The ship will undergo hundreds of tests. Elon Musk will no doubt be ready to lose dozens of faulty unmanned prototypes rather than risk something going wrong with the actual manned mission. A disaster on a mission of this scale could spell the end of for-profit space exploration if investors get skittish. The astronauts likewise will no doubt be given extensive briefings, psychological and physical tests, and training to ensure they are fully equipped for everything on the journey. But once they land, it is truly uncharted territory. No one has ever set foot on Mars, at least that we know of. We don't know what's buried in the soil of Mars, and that's no doubt going to be a part of the mission. But before the astronauts get there, there is no shortage of T's to cross and I's to dot. After all, the astronauts are 140 million miles away from the Earth, and there are no do-overs in deep space. The first landing crew will be chosen, including the all-important first person to set foot on Mars. It's likely to be chosen by an exhaustive process. Unless Elon Musk is on the ship, and he likely will be, then the boss man will no doubt ensure that he gets the honor as the bankroller of the mission. Will he plant an American flag or a Tesla one? And soon the astronauts will be wishing that they were still chilling on the long road to Mars. This will no doubt be the most intense part of the mission. Once the landing crew touches down, they won't be alone for long. Soon, most of the remaining crew, except those needed for Starship operations, will leave the ship and begin the long, grueling process of building the outpost that this entire mission will be designed around. This will mean carefully scouting an area that is far more inhospitable than anywhere on Earth, and quite a bit of robot-assisted labor. And it'll all be done wearing those bulky astro suits that we all know so well, because until the artificial gravity and air is set up on Mars, the entire place is inhospitable to human life. Which means that even if one thing goes wrong, it's curtains. One of the most important things that the astronauts will be tasked with before they get on board is troubleshooting. This is largely new technology, as no one has ever made an attempt to settle on Mars before. So it can basically be guaranteed something will go wrong. And everyone who's on board will need to know how to fix it. While there will be specialized teams for each area of equipment, odds are everyone will know the basics, because sometimes it comes down to who's around at any given moment. And the reward for all this hard work? Well, they'll get to do it all over again. It's not clear how long the first manned mission to Mars will stay there, but it's not likely to be as long as some hoped. It was initially talked about as a one-way mission, with people settling there, but that's rather unrealistic. The first mission will be about setting up infrastructure that can be built upon by a future crew. So the first team of astronauts will be made up of scientists and workers rather than colonists. and the trip's resources will be strictly rationed so everyone can have enough for the way back, because the return trip is just as long as the way there, and it might be even more difficult. One question that's often asked about the first manned mission to Mars is whether everyone will be awake for the duration. Hollywood often shows long-distance space missions where people are put into cryo sleep and then conveniently wake up at the right time. But this technology doesn't exist yet, and the other alternative is a form of sedation that would reduce the resources people need for the trip. But any combination of drugs has its risks, and no one is sure how they would interact with the effects of space. So doing this the old-fashioned way is the safest bet for the first round, and that could come with some unique psychological effects. We've all been there. It was the vacation of a lifetime, and now you're headed home. And just like that, you're reminded that it's back to everyday life with school or work tomorrow, and the weight of that ennui just comes crashing down. There's a reason Disney's shuttle to the airport used to be nicknamed the Tragical Express. Now take that effect, make it coming back from the adventure of a lifetime in deep space, and give everyone months to reflect on it. The odds are the return trip from Mars might be even more fraught with those tense emotions than the way there. Of course, the astronauts aren't actually going back to their old lives. There's no doubt that when the first crew returns from Mars, they'll also be the most famous people on Earth. Just like Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin were after Apollo 11. We see you, Michael Collins. But fame comes with its own challenges. NASA and SpaceX will be waiting with an army of medical and psychological experts ready to run a battery of tests before the astronauts meet the public and face the media frenzy ahead. Because being in space that long can affect the body in all sorts of ways. Past astronauts have reported a significant decrease in bone density and trouble adjusting to Earth's gravity at first after returning. And this is a much longer trip than anyone's ever experienced. Starship is prepared to compensate for this, but no one can be sure exactly of how the body will react to a trip of this length. The only thing that is for sure is that the astronauts will be entering a brave new world, one that is very different from the world they left. They're now a part of history whether they like it or not, and it all started when they set foot on the world's largest spaceship. What part of life aboard Starship do you think will be the biggest challenge? Zero gravity, isolation, or something else entirely? And if given the chance, would you take a one-way trip to Mars? Let us know in the comments. Want to know what the astronauts could be searching for deep under the Martian soil? Check out Why People Think Mars Was Once Inhabited by Humans, or watch How Humanity Will Actually Colonize Mars Year by Year for a speculative look at just how big this project could get if the mission works out.